Hello, this is our presentation on Sea Shanties by Mitchell Frey, Ryan Zinn, Jocelyn McAbin, and me, Kaelin Shea.
Come, all you young fellows who follow the sea.
Away, hey, blow the man down.
And pray pay attention and listen to me.
Give me some time to blow the man down.
I'm a deep water sailor just in from Hong Kong.
Away, hey, blow the man down.
If you buy me a drink, then I'll sing you a song.
Yeah. Give me some time to blow the man down.
Some of the first impressions of sea shanties include the classic call and response that is featured in a lot of the tunes. The call and response music was used for coordinating labor on commercial ships to be more efficient as a group. The genre of maritime traditional folk songs that came from the early 18th century heavily influenced sea shanties. African American laborers that sailed along the U.S. Gulf Coast were some of the first people to sing these songs. The word shanty was derived from the French word chanter, which means to sing. Now let's talk about the relevant background of the sea shanty. Sea shanties are the special work songs that were sung by crew members of wood and wind-powered commercial ships during the 19th century. These ships were often large and required a lot of skill and cooperation from the entire crew to operate. So shanties would be sung to coordinate multiple crew members that were performing a task at the same time. The lyrics often reference the tasks that the crew members were constantly doing, such as hauling and pulling, which would be performed when those lyrics appeared in the tune. Other lyrics reference mythical sailors, various trading companies, and crude humor. To add on to the background of sea shanties, the shantyman was a sailor who led the others in singing, much like a male lead in a choir. He was usually self-appointed, and a good shantyman was a sailor who was valued and respected. Shantymen sometimes received extra financial compensation for their work, but it was commonly paid with extra rations of food or booze. Naval sailors did not sing any shanties because they were considered bad decorum, and Navy ships usually had large crews when compared to the commercial vessels. This meant that they did not need to work as hard to maximize efficiency. Navy ships altogether were also more strict when it came to finishing their tasks, and sometimes the people that sang the sea shanties looked like they were messing around or having a good time rather than working. Shanties fell out of favor with the emergence of steamships, since work for large coordinated groups of sailors was not as necessary anymore.
Let's talk a little bit about the musical characteristics of sea shanties. Many shanties had a call and response format, with one voice, the shantyman, singing the solo lines and the rest of the sailors bellowing short refrains in response while performing their coordinated work. This call and response style came from African slaves, sailors, and workers in the American South and Caribbean. Most real shanties that were used for coordinating work on ships had very simple harmonies, or were often sung in unison with no instrumental accompaniment. They were often in triple meter and had a melodic style that reflected Irish folk songs. The canon of shanties was very diverse. Some can be traced back to African American work songs and spirituals, theater songs of vaudeville and music halls, and even much older British songs and ballads. Others were pretty clearly written by sailors at sea. What are some of the types of shanties? Short haul or short drag shanties were used for tasks that required a few coordinated pulls. One of the best known is Haul Away Joe.
When I was a little boy, so me mother told me, tell me,
halyard shanties were used for setting sails on movable spars called yards. The ropes that hauled these yards were the halyards and gave their name to this class of songs. This work was somewhat more sustained and precise than the short drags, and longer songs with brisk call and responses were called for. One of our favorite halyard shanties is Hanging Johnny, which is a good example of the shanty's use of wordplay. In some cases, when many men were hauling on the same rope, those who were grasping it high above their heads pulled by simply letting their knees go limp and hanging with their entire body weight to do the task.
Oh, they calls me Hangin' Johnny.
Away, boys, away.
They say I hangs for money.
So hang, boys, hang.
They say I hangs for money.
Away, boys, away.
'Cause hanging is so funny.
So hang, boys, hang.
Oh, first I hung me daddy.
Away, boys, away.
Stamp and go, or walk-away shanties, were used for hauling on the weather braces in order to tack the ship. And when using a mysterious apparatus called the Devil's Instrument to scrape barnacles and other accretions off the ship's bottom. According to Stan Hugel, each captain had his own Devil's Instrument design. One of the best known Stamp and Go shanties was an African-American religious song which went to sea, known as We'll Roll the Chariot Along. Shanties were used for continuous sustained tasks, such as pumping the ship dry, warping the ship into dock, and raising the anchor. Those tasks use a capstan, a machine that translates the manpower of sailors walking around in a circle into a continuous force on a rope or chain. Here in the top right corner, we see some sailors spinning a capstan.
What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor?
Windlass shanties were used to accompany work at the patent windlass, which was designed to raise anchor and was operated by a seesaw-like device to pull the chain.
Come, he's gone, that good old man.
Hello, my name is Mitchell Frey, and I will be comparing the sea shanty tradition with other kinds of sea songs, as well as mentioning some of the most notable figures regarding the sea shanty tradition in modern times. Now, as mentioned earlier, it's important to note that shanties are work songs, they're occupational songs, and they were sung while performing physical labor. Now, songs about the life of a sailor, even if they are written or performed by the sailors, isn't still technically a shanty, unless it's performed during the work, during the labor. They did have some, recreational songs, some songs that were for fun that they sang off duty. Those are just considered as sea songs, simply as sea songs, because they have no consistent formal characteristics. Now, some literary references do kind of characterize them by using the term, focal songs or four-biters or off-watch songs, which just references the place on the ship and times that they would sing them. But really, they, in terms of the larger folklore community, they aren't considered anything specific besides just the term sea songs. Now, as mentioned earlier, around the late 19th century, earlier 20th century, with the invention of steam, you had the displacement of a lot of sailors and a lot of these sea shanty traditions. But at that same time, right, you had this nationalistic movement in the collection of folklore, mainly in Britain, but also in the United States, as sort of this, you know, the sea song as representative of a national identity, or the kind of culture that was important to them, you know, the hard kind of manly image. It was very romanticized, but it's important to notice that they were written that a lot of songs around that time were written for the stage, although they borrowed more sea shanty styles. And there's a lot of debate in the community whether those songs are still considered sea shanties, although they were never actually in use during the time that sea shanties were used, which was only from, again, the 1830s, 1840s to sort of the end of the 19th century. Now, like we mentioned earlier with that nationalistic movement, right, one of the most important figures regarding this sea shanty tradition is Stan Hugel. He was a Welsh sailor who basically spent his entire life studying and performing and collecting the sea shanties. He spent, you know, pretty much his entire life doing it. Now, he wrote a book in 1961 called Shanties from the Seven Seas. And this book was really considered the last word on shanties in sort of the modern age. It really stamped, you know, the end of the era of just the collection of shanties, because it was so detailed and it was so thorough that a lot of people felt like there wasn't much more to be said. I mean, a lot of his experience, too, again, as an actual sailor, you know, came from direct shantiers, you know, and so it's important to recognize that. Because of this, because he actually was a sailor and wasn't just a folklore specialist on this, he earned the moniker basically the last shantyman, as he was one of the last people to really experience this tradition as it was alive, and collect it for everyone else. So he was a traveling performer as well as an academic through his life, as well as writing books. He also toured the entire world, spreading and singing shanties and sharing the maritime traditions with many different cultures. Now, like I mentioned earlier, with the huge nationalistic movement in Britain and especially in America, he kind of became the central figure of this. His Welsh origin really embodied that nationalistic image for Britain. And also, he kind of represented this romanticized idea of the sailor and the sailing lifestyle. You know, he cursed and he drank, and he kind of represented this manliness that a lot of people connected to, like, and associated with the sailing lifestyle. Now, it's important to note that a lot of his shanties that he did collect in his novels, in his volumes, weren't from British origin. Like we mentioned earlier, a lot of these songs came from, you know, African-American laborers. They came from colonial ships, merchant ships, stuff like that. And he actually went and traveled with them. A lot of people from the West Indies, stuff like that. He did collect all of those songs, but just the fact that a lot of people were using his novel as, you know, the first stop on shanties means it kind of muddled a lot of the origins of a lot of these songs. The fact that, you know, he was this Welsh sailor, a lot of people started to associate that British national identity with a lot of these songs, although their origins, you know, were very different. So that's just an important part to note. But yeah, Stan Hugel was easily one of the most important figures regarding the collection and really the modern association with sea shanties. And a lot of folklore specialists do basically consider the collection of sea shanties as a, you know, pre-Stan Hugel era and a post-Stan Hugel era. But yeah.
So now we are going to be talking about shanties in popular music / popular culture. Sea shanties became a trend on TikTok in early 2021, spawning a bunch of covers as well as new works. TikTok and other social media platforms brought about a new interest in the genre, encouraging other people to join in on the trend and collaborate with others. It became something that most users knew about, even if they didn't directly participate in it. While some of the shanties that went viral are actually whaling songs and not shanties at all, these videos nevertheless introduced a large amount of people to the genre. The resurgence of the genre through these social media websites during the pandemic provided an outlet for people to feel a sense of community. The first link on the next slide is to a TikTok that went really viral and spawned this whole trend of TikTok shanties. The song is The Wellerman, and it's actually a whaling song and not a shanty.
Once was a ship that put to sea. The name of the ship was a Belly of Tea. The winds blew up her bow, dipped down below my billy boys blow. Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
Next link on this slide is to a parody of The Wellerman. The creator created her own lyrics about a pug named Noodle, who was also a trend on TikTok, and set them to the melody of the song.
There once was a pug that could foresee if our day ahead was merry or bleak. Every day all of TikTok asked,
is it a bones day or no?
Woof!
Noodle, the pug so cute, for our mental health we look to you. Oh, isn't a bones day, so back into bed we go.
Now I'm going to move on to the review questions. Number 1. Sea shanties were sung on what types of ships? A. Commercial ships. B. Pirate ships. C. Steamships. Or D. Navy ships. Number 2. Sea shanties are based on what musical styles? A. Irish folk music. B. Baroque counterpoint. C. African call and response. And or D. Argentinian tango. Select all that apply. Number 3. Which one is the name of a sea shanty? A. Runaway shanty. B. Windlass shanty. C. Long haul shanty. Or D. Shipyard shanty. Number 4. True or false? The captain of the ship leads the shanties. Now I'm going to move on to the answers of the review questions. For number 1, if you answered commercial ships, you are correct. For number 2, the answers were A, Irish folk music, and C, African call and response. Number 3, the answer was B, windlass shanty. And for number 4, the answer is false. The shantyman leads the shanties, not the captain.
When I was a little boy, so me mother told me, tell me,
way, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
That if I did not kiss the girls, the pirates would all grow moldy, tell me,
way,